So welcome, everybody. I'm Barry Friedman, and this is the forum. We're here to talk about the Citizens United case. I want to remind everybody now, because I will surely forget, that we videotaped this for webcasting, and so if you choose to speak at a later point in the gathering, you will appear on camera. I also want to, before I do anything else, this program is jointly sponsored both by the Vice Dean's Office, but also by the Brennan Center for Justice, the Voting Justice Project here at NYU, and the NYU ACLU. I particularly want to thank Susan Lehman, who couldn't be here today, but who was instrumental in putting this all together. And so she deserves our thanks, and she can watch the videotape, and she'll know that I did what I was told. So the Citizens United case, as you all know, created quite a stir, maybe more than the justices themselves expected. After the decision came down, the president criticized the decision. There was the incident at the State of the Union address. All of the polling I've seen shows widespread dissatisfaction on the left and the right equally at about the same levels. But today our topic is how should we feel about the decision, what did it involve, where do we go from here, what's the picture look like, and we have a really extraordinary panel of folks to talk to you about it. So I'm going to just introduce everybody very briefly, and then we'll get to their remarks. To my right is somebody that I think I reasonably can call Mr. First Amendment, Floyd Abrams. He's a partner at Cahill Gordon. It's hard to think of an important First Amendment case in which he was not involved. He argued the Citizens United case, and we're very glad to have him here. When we get to the remarks part of this, he's got a few extra minutes to sort of brief us in on the case and then do his shtick. To my left is somebody that I suppose I could call Mr. Democracy, our own Sam Azakharov. So he's one of the authors of the leading casebook on the subject. In fact, I think at some level they created the subject. He's expert in many areas, but is deeply involved in litigation around election law issues. So we're lucky to have him. And finally, to my far left, is somebody I suppose we could call Ms. Campaign Finance Reform. Monica Yoon from the Brennan Center. So Monica, who is, by the way, also a poet, which I admire enormously, but who leads the project on campaign finance reform at the Brennan Center and wrote a brief in the Citizens United case. So we're going to go in the order. We negotiated this all out earlier this week, and I think I have it correctly. Floyd, then Monica, then Sam. So Floyd.
Hi. Good morning, everyone. We meet on a day that the New York Times has referred to this decision as disastrous and deeply undemocratic. And as the proponent of the decision, not alone in that respect, I thought I would start out, and I haven't given a few extra minutes, to try to give a non-adversarial articulation of how the case proceeded and what the background to it was. The Taft-Hartley law was adopted in 1947. It was the first law which made it illegal for corporations to engage in independent expenditure, to spend their own treasury funds on federal election. Long before that, campaign contributions by corporations had been banned, but not till 1947 was there a ban on expenditures, spending by the companies themselves. President Truman vetoed the bill, saying it was a violation of the First Amendment. It was passed over his veto and became law. There were a few cases in the 50s and 60s, some criminal prosecutions of labor union leaders. In all of them, the Supreme Court ducked the issue of the constitutionality of the provisions that we're going to be talking about today, sometimes indicating great qualms about the constitutionality, sometimes not. By the time the Citizens Union case came to the Supreme Court, there were four or five cases which I think really laid the groundwork for what happened there. First, in Buckley versus Vallejo, which has been referred to as the most criticized case in the 20th century. We may already have gone beyond that in the 21st. The court distinguished between contributions and independent expenditures for purposes of analysis. They basically said that contributions could be regulated, that there was a serious First Amendment interest in being allowed to make contributions as one chose, but that that could be overcome because of the social needs of society, and in light of the fact that contributions were sort of so close to the candidate, giving the candidate money. Independent expenditures, the court said, could not be regulated. It was protected by the First Amendment. It was unclear for a number of years whether corporations were included in the range of entities about which the court was saying that. The court didn't say anything about corporations. One of the parties to the case was the New York Civil Liberties Union, which was a corporation, and there were arguments in the courts later on through the years as to whether the court had or had not included corporations in their articulation of the proposition that independent expenditures could not be regulated by Congress. Ultimately, the Supreme Court said that it was not included. What's clear is that they didn't talk about corporations at all. There were some cases, though, which did talk about corporations and speech. The Bilotti case, a very well-known case in the late 1970s, Massachusetts case in which Massachusetts had passed a law barring corporations from taking positions, spending money to take out ads with respect to the adoption or opposition to referenda in the states. The Supreme Court said that was unconstitutional, said that corporations were entitled to First Amendment rights, said that the point of it all, after all, was more speech for the public to hear, take advantage of having, and that corporations were not excluded from the class of entities that could engage in that speech. A later case, the Pacific Gas and Electric case, raised a similar issue. They're a for-profit company, the electric company in California, would put in their billing folders a newspaper-like newsletter that they had prepared, which basically said things about politics, about some social issues, and about electricity and the like. This was a highly regulated industry. The commission which oversaw it made a ruling to the effect that they had to share their envelope, so to speak, with critics of the electricity power industry. That issue wound up going to the Supreme Court, and in a plurality opinion, joined among others by Justice Brennan, the court said the fact that this is a corporation, a for-profit corporation, didn't make any difference. They quoted from the Bilotti case in saying that. They said that, indeed, because it was political speech, it was more protected, not less, something I'll come to, and that, therefore, the California authorities could neither bar the company from putting in their political pamphlet with the bills, nor compel them to put in pamphlets or positions on these issues which they disagreed. The next big case, and very big it was the Michigan Chamber of Commerce versus Austin, which is one of the cases reversed in Citizens Union. Michigan statute which banned corporations from spending independent expenditures on behalf of or against candidates. The Michigan Chamber of Commerce took out an ad, endorsed a candidate, and that case went to the Supreme Court in 1990. And in that case, the Supreme Court upheld the Michigan ban, saying in substance, or to put it this way, relying in particular on a theory that had not before been expressed by the court. And that was the dangers of the corrosive, as the court put it, and distorting impact of money on politics and corporate money in particular on politics. And based on that, and especially, the court upheld the Michigan statute and ruled against the Chamber of Commerce. In 2002, after Congress had adopted the McCain-Feingold law, that law was challenged. I was involved in that case, represented Senator McConnell in what became the McConnell versus Federal Election Commission case. And in that case, the court upheld against a facial challenge the provision of the McCain-Feingold law, which basically said within 60 days of an election, 30 days of a primary, 30 days of a convention, that no union or corporate money could be used on cable, television, or satellite, which mentioned the name of a candidate for federal office. In a later decision of the Supreme Court, the court narrowed or really effectively struck down part of that, leaving it to read, within that 60-day, 30-day period, no union or corporate funds could be used with respect to speech, which did nothing more or less than call upon the viewer to vote for or against a particular candidate. All of these decisions, to some extent, not Buckley, but everyone I've mentioned had strong dissenting opinions, and by strong, now I'm not putting a valuation on it, angry dissenting opinions. Everyone had a lot of members of the court, usually three, often four, denouncing the ruling of the court. Now, Citizens Union comes along. Citizens Union is a right-wing group which spends about, or which is worth about, I guess, spends about $12 million a year. A small percentage of that money comes from corporate grants. Most of it is from individual grants. They prepared a movie called Hillary, the Movie, denouncing Hillary Clinton at the time when it looked as if she would be nominated by the Democratic Party as their candidate in the last presidential election. The movie is extremely rough on then Senator Clinton. It was hard, I think, for any independent viewer to view it as anything but a call to vote against her for president. Citizens United went to the three-judge district court established by federal statute, made a variety of arguments, most of them rather narrow in nature, saying, for example, that they wanted to put this on video on demand. Video on demand is not the same as television, cable, or satellite. That was what was banned by the statute, they argued, not video on demand. The three-judge court ruled against them. The majority of the Supreme Court, at least, ruled against them on that, as well as other narrower ways of dealing with the case. So what did the Supreme Court rule in Citizens Union? Justice Kennedy, writing for the 5-4 majority, basically said two things in his opinion. First, this is political speech. Nothing is more political speech than who to vote for president, and no speech is more protected than speech about who to vote for president. And second, that there was, citing 21 cases, a longstanding rule of law that corporations and unions, both of which are covered by the Act, corporations and unions, are entitled to First Amendment freedom of speech rights under the First Amendment. Many of those cases were media cases. I remember arguing one of them in the late 1970s when Chief Justice Rehnquist, at a time when I didn't know this at the moment, when the Bilotti case was under consideration by the court, and I was representing a Virginia newspaper, And Chief Justice Rehnquist asked me, is it your position that it makes any difference that you're representing a corporation? And I blinked once or twice and said, well, the court has certainly decided a lot of cases, New York Times versus Sullivan being one of them, in which corporations were in front of you claiming free speech and free press rights, and you've never indicated before that that could make a difference. If it did, I said something like this, if it did, you know, what sort of First Amendment rights would be left, since almost all the litigants in front of you, at least on the press side, are organized in corporate form. The Bilotti case came down later, no thanks to anything I had to say about it, and said what it said. So the part of Justice Kennedy's opinion in which he said that corporations were protected in their free speech rights, or that they had them, cited about 22 cases. Most of them, but not all, were cases involving media companies. Some of them, like the two I've mentioned already, Bilotti and Pacific Gas, were for-profit corporations. And he articulated the general proposition that, that as a general matter, we don't limit speech based on who's speaking, that we protect speech because it's a good thing to have it, regardless of who the speaker is. And on that basis, the court, the new majority of the court, overruled the Austin case, which it viewed as an outlier, and so much of the McConnell case as was based on Austin. My own view is and was that this was a case in which the speech involved was, as Justice Kennedy said, as protected as any sort of speech one could draft, hypothetically or otherwise. A speech, a documentary denouncing a candidate for president of the United States, that the notion to me, then and now, that that sort of speech can be criminalized seemed to me and seems to me anathema to the First Amendment. Obviously, if any individual had made that movie and this sort of statute were in effect, I don't think there'd be much disagreement that the First Amendment would require a ruling that it was unconstitutional. To me, as to the majority of the court, the fact that the speaker was itself a corporation, Citizens United, and had received some corporate money, as it had and does, doesn't change the equation and shouldn't change the equation. So from my own perspective then, this was a case which, like a lot of First Amendment cases, leads to an unpopular result, leads to a result where one cannot predict the future as to the level of consequences on the ground in the future. I mean, 25 states have allowed this for a long time, and there's been no great inflow or outflow of corporate money. But who's to say what'll happen? My First Amendment is not one which requires me to predict the future, because I think I've learned how hard it is to do it. So I leave you then with the notion that to say that this speech, whoever put it out, this speech is not protected by the First Amendment ought to be very troubling. And the fact that four members of the Supreme Court were prepared to sign on to the notion that this speech was not protected by the First Amendment is or should be very troubling indeed. Thank you.
Thank you, Floyd. So next, Monica. You're on.
I'll just turn on a stopwatch here so I can be sure on my time. Floyd left you with a thought, is this speech protected by the First Amendment? And Really, what I find the most disturbing aspect of Citizens United is the extent to which what the justices seem to think they are talking about is different from what the case at hand in front of them is. Because the issue is not whether a corporation has a, you know, can be as rough on Hillary Clinton as it wants to, whether or not the government is going to censor or suppress the content of that message. Even before this case, ExxonMobil had the right to establish a political PAC to support Exxon's agenda, to say, hey, Exxon people, who here supports, you know, drilling in the Arctic, who here supports any, you know, supports our position on climate change regulation, let's get together as Exxon PAC and let's run ads, and we can be as rough on Hillary Clinton or on Chuck Schumer or anyone as we want to be. The question in front of the court was, whose money do you get to use to pay for these ads? And, you know, the prohibition at issue in 441B was that if you're going to advance the Exxon agenda, you should make sure that the people who are advancing the Exxon agenda want to advance the Exxon agenda. You should do what I would have to do if I wanted to run a film that was critical of Hillary Clinton. I would get together with some of my friends, we would solicit donations, we would form a political action committee, and we could say anything about Hillary Clinton that we wanted to. This is not about whether the speech is protected, and I think that the court's kind of sleight of hand around this issue, for me, is really the most troubling aspect of a very troubling opinion. So Citizens United is a case about whether or not the First Amendment prohibits the regulation of corporate political spending. And to equate corporate political spending with speech absolutely requires that you accept three metaphors. You know, you'll recognize some of these from your con law class, one of which is money is speech. Now, clearly money enables speech. Money has some relation to speech. But money is regulated all the time in ways that do not, you know, cause people to cry First Amendment foul. You know, the regulation of money and the regulation of speech are two conceptually different things. The second thing is that corporations are people. And again, corporate spending is regulated all of the time. A corporation is not permitted by law to spend in a way that violates the business judgment rule. A corporation is not permitted to spend in a way that wastes corporate assets. As an individual, I don't have to satisfy a business judgment rule. I can waste every cent of my paycheck on, you know, frivolous things, and no one is going to call me on it. There is a difference. Well, someone will call me on it, but no one has a legal right to call me on it. And the third metaphor is that election should be a marketplace. An election is something that is a forum that the person with the most money has a constitutional right to monopolize, and a corporation has the right to buy as much influence as it can afford. And this is, I think, a problem in a democracy that's founded on an idea of one person, one vote, a system of self-governance that is predicated on we the people. There is some inherent notion of equality there. I mean, the New York City Board of Elections sends out a voter guide, and no one says just because Bloomberg has more money than his opponent that Bloomberg should have 90 pages in this voter guide and and his opponent should have one. No matter how rich or poor I am, I can only spend $4,800 in an election. That's true for me, that's true for the millionaire who, you know, lives, you know, down the road. There's something about elections that is there to promote informed decision-making by the electorate. And the idea of electoral regulation is that voters, rather than special interests, should be at the center of our political system. That at the end of the day, what should count is how many votes you get, not how much money you're spending. So this is what, you know, I found very frustrating about the Kennedy opinion, because Kennedy will say things like the government has muffled the voices of corporations, and the purpose of effect of this law is to silence entities whose voices the government deems to be suspect. And he hypothesizes at one point the government could silence a corporate objector to a particular policy or cycle. He's pretending this case is about censorship. And this is not a case about censorship. This is not about trying to say we should not have the widest possible variety of viewpoints out there. Even Citizens United could have put out its, you know, movie about Hillary Clinton. They could have done it in a DVD. They could have put it in movie theaters. They could have, you know, put it in a variety of ways. Instead, they chose to do so in a way that was a test case for the election law. They could even have done so by just taking individual contributions rather than the for-profit political money. There's an exemption for that as well. We're not talking about censorship based on the content of speech here. And, you know, there's an interesting thought exercise that at one point late at night I was doing when reading through Kennedy's opinion, because Kennedy's opinion is rhetorical in, I think, the worst sense of the word. If you actually substitute what he's talking about, unlimited corporate political spending, for what he pretends he's talking about, free speech, then you get sentences like, so here's me substituting speech, unlimited political spending in for speech. Unlimited corporate political spending is an essential mechanism of democracy, for it is the means to hold officials accountable to the people. The right of corporations to spend treasury funds on independent expenditures is a precondition to enlightened self-government and a necessary means to protect it. This is so problematic because we were talking about the judiciary here. I mean, this is the language of advocacy. This is not the language of judicial decision making. It is as if you have a Supreme Court striking down healthcare reform saying, well, you know, the death panels oppose the Constitution, you know, are in violation of the constitutional rights of senior citizens. You know, we're not talking about death panels, and similarly, we're not talking about censorship. You know, there's the problem with the court's fantasy vision of censorship here is it ignores the real problem of what happens in special interest domination of politics. It was asserted several times at oral argument that there's no evidence of, you know, problems in the states that don't have these safeguards. And in fact, there is evidence of problems in the states that don't have these safeguards. That evidence, due to the way this factual record came before the court, was not considered by the court and was not presented by the court. I mean, let's look at a case in North Carolina. A farmers' lobby got together and decided that they wanted a legislator who was a swing vote on farm subsidies to vote in favor of those farm subsidies. So they produced a smear ad campaign. Of course, the ad had nothing to do with farm subsidies. It was an attack on this legislator's personal life. Did they air the ad? No. They took the ad to the legislator's office in private. They screened this attack ad campaign for this legislator and said, if you do not vote for our farm bill, this is the ad campaign we are going to run. The problem with Citizens United is not going to be about the floodgates. It's not about responsible corporations flooding the system with money. I don't know that they will necessarily do that. But what it does, the problem is not the floodgates. The problem is the back door and the lifting of the safeguards that we've put in place to keep you know, our elections from being bought out from under us. Thank you.
Thank you, Monica. I wonder whether we have a developing tradition of signaling approval with the substance of remarks by the nature of the applause. Sam, let's hope you get a lot of applause.
Let's hope not. So I find myself sort of in the middle on this issue. I don't share Floyd's fundamental view of the First Amendment. I read the Supreme Court's major First Amendment cases going back to New York Times versus Sullivan as largely about a concern on governmental motivation rather than an entitlement on behalf of particular speakers. So that if you go back even into New York Times versus Sullivan, you see Justice Brennan torn between two competing arguments. One is that there was an absolute right to express these views, and the second was that we are deeply skeptical of the claim of state authority to be utilized in any fashion against these views. Now, this came to a head, this tension in the First Amendment came to a head in the initial argument of Citizens United, in which Deputy Solicitor General Malcolm Stewart was asked what the governmental interest was and how far it would extend. And at one point, he was asked directly, could the government ban books if under the power that you assert here? True, the particular statute did not reach books, only different kinds of media broadcasting, but it said, could you ban books? And Stewart looked at the court and said, yes. Now, that is the third rail of the First Amendment. You do not touch that. We all have the image of the Nazis in Germany burning the books. And the idea that a deputy solicitor general would get up and say, we in the United States have the power to burn books also, was anathema to the court, and everything shut down at that point. So it set up the rehearing, and what I find extraordinary and troubling about the majority opinion and the Scalia concurrence is that it reaches beyond the prohibition on government incentives and government motives and government power and creates a broad-based entitlement theory of the First Amendment and extends this to corporations. It wasn't necessary to do this, in my view. The case could have been resolved otherwise without doing this. And in fact, it could have reached the same sweeping results of overturning Austin, which in my view should have been overturned, all of that without reaching that. Now, my personal view is actually closest to that of then Justice Rehnquist in the Bilotti case. And my view is corporations are creatures of the state. As long as they're created with certain encumbrances that the state creates, so be it. Now, that doesn't mean, as General Kagan discovered in the Supreme Court, that post hoc you can create a shareholder protection rationale for what is clearly not a shareholder protection move. Read the Congressional Black Caucus expose in Sunday's Times, and you will see that corporations give money in many different ways. Go look at the names of all our ball fields, all our symphony halls, all our whatever public monument you want, and you will see corporations using their treasuries in ways that have nothing to do with narrow profit maximization. If we are concerned about shareholder wealth, either we regulate all non-economic activity of the corporations, or we become suspicious that there is selective regulation aimed at certain kinds of expression and not at others. And at that point, in my view, the First Amendment does kick in. But the court went much further. Now, what does this mean? Where does the law stand now? There are three things that I think are important to keep in mind. The first is, there was no settled law before this. Buckley v. Valeo is almost 35 years old. And Buckley v. Valeo set up a divide between contributions and expenditures and said the only legitimate governmental rationale in this is stopping corruption. And Buckley v. Valeo has failed and failed and failed the test of subsequent cases. It is absolutely extraordinary that for about 15 years now, there has been a solid majority in every single campaign finance case, sometimes 5 votes, sometimes 6 votes, on one occasion 7 votes, to overturn Buckley v. Valeo. And the only reason it lasts is because they want to push it in different directions. And so you have between 2 and sometimes, generously, 4 votes to maintain Buckley v. Valeo. So when there's a claim by the Stevens dissent that this is a radical opinion by Kennedy because it overturns a lot of settled law, please. There's nothing settled in this area, and certainly Austin, which was the main case relied upon, is an outlier because it rejects the core Buckley belief that the only governmental interest is corruption. It defines corruption not as the quid pro quo of getting elected officials to do something, but corrupting us, the voters, because we're so stupid that we're going to be overwhelmed by this stuff, and therefore our thought process, our participation as democratic citizens is going to be corrupted. That's why I was quoted in the Times saying this is an outlier. This is not a serious opinion. My poor mother calls me up and says, you were misquoted again in the paper. How could they do this to you? No, Mom. know, read my articles, goddammit. So I hope she's not watching. So that's the first point. Second point. This is an important case. It's a significant case in American constitutional law, well beyond the narrow question of campaign finance or Hillary the movie or anything else, because it poses a confrontation between the two major constitutional traditions of the 20th century. One is the idea of the equality of citizens. Monica referred to one person, one vote. Keep in mind, that's relatively new. That's only half a century old, but that's been a commitment of our democracy. And the idea that going back to the early one person, one vote cases, that the court wanted each individual, and this is the language of Reynolds versus Sims, to have an equally effective voice in the political process. Extraordinary aspiration. But the other tradition is the liberty tradition, which is highly distrusting of government and highly distrusting of and giving the state the power over ideas. And that's why this is a great case, because these two traditions, which are important to the liberal ethos of our country and to 20th century constitutional law, come together in direct conflict. And it corresponds to a distrust that's in the body politic also. We don't like big concentrations of money, right? So you saw the Scott Brown election, you saw this populist anger over the banks control everything, but we also don't like big concentrations of government. And so we have these two traditions, and they're expressed constitutionally by liberty and equality, and here they come into conflict. Final point, and that is, in my view, where the law stands right now after Citizens United is probably the worst possible place for it. Because my concern in this area is not a constitutional one, but a policy one, a regulatory one. And that is, as in all matters of regulatory life, when you overregulate in one domain, money will flow to the unregulated peripheries. And in this case, what that means is that we have found over and over that the only place we can regulate money is going to the candidates and the parties. And so that's where our regulatory impulse is, because we don't do public funding on a national level. We never have, and likely we never will. And so what happens when we squeeze the parties and the candidates? Well, in the first instance, you got PACs. PACs proved not to be the most efficient way. Then you got the independent expenditure committees. Then you get the 527s. And so you find our politics dominated by these tertiary groups that tend to be single issue groups. They tend to be extremist groups. They tend to poison the political atmosphere because all they run is hate ads. Why? They're not running for office. They don't have to do anything. If you wanted to design regulatory policy, however you get the money into the system, you want it to go to the people who are accountable for where they got the money and are accountable before us, the voters. And so what the upshot of Citizens United is that unions and corporations now are free to engage in independent expenditures, but never to give money to candidates who have to be accountable for where they took their money from. As a regulatory policy matter, I think that that's the worst of all worlds right now.
Thank you, Sam. I think what I'd like to do, because even though speech is free, people haven't bought too much of it so far, is Floyd, if you want a minute or two just to respond, but no more than that, just to bring it full circle, and then we'll open it up for questions.
Sure. First, is this censorship or not? Think of the case. Think of this case, our case, Citizens United case. They make a movie criticizing Hillary Clinton, and it is a crime to put it on television. That's what the law made it. It's a crime to put it on television. I'm sorry, my First Amendment is not one which leads me to say, well, yeah, but they could have shown it in a theater. I mean, we know the cases. Those of you that have taken First Amendment cases know that's not an answer to a First Amendment challenge. Well, you can see it elsewhere. You can do something else. You can do something you don't want to do. Or you can use a PAC. Look, a PAC is the individuals of a company. It's not the company. Maybe the company shouldn't be allowed. But don't tell me a PAC is the same as the company. In fact, it wouldn't exist if it were the same as the company. I mean, we have here what seems to me to be a classic, if somewhat unusual, case of pure censorship, and it doesn't matter what the intentions of Congress are. That may matter down the road if Congress takes a variety of steps and we go back and look at legislative history to see why they did it and the like. It seems to me that we have a situation here where, yes, as Sam says, there was a clash, and there's always been a clash of egalitarian instincts against liberty-oriented instincts. The Supreme Court in general has come out, and in any event, in this case, certainly came out on the liberty side. In Buckley, the best known line from Buckley is the concept that government may restrict the speech of some elements of our society in order to enhance the relative voice of others is wholly foreign to the First Amendment. I think it is foreign to the First Amendment. Finally, there are things we can do if society wanted to do them to corporations without limiting speech. That's usually the way, isn't it? That we deal with social problems. That's usually the way that the Supreme Court says, go find some non-speech way of doing it. Tax them. Have different antitrust laws. Say they can't be bigger than a certain size. You can make up your own hypotheticals, let alone the particular ones that Senator Schumer and others have talked about. There are ways to reduce the power of corporations, if that's what we think we should do. But the way Congress did it, in part for reasons Sam has expressed, but I'm on the other side of Sam on that which is his concern. Congress didn't want these outside groups to be dictating, as Congress, as candidates view it, what people should talk about. They don't want to talk about abortion. Sometimes neither side wants to talk about abortion because they can lose more votes than they can win by it. My answer is, not my problem. Not my problem as a citizen to tell me that the people who run for office would rather not talk about this or that, or that extreme groups will take charge of the campaign system. My answer is, let's play out the political system. Let's play out in a free speech political system. There's no doubt people with more money in America have more power in America throughout the totality of our lives. But the way to deal with that is not by limiting speech, but any one of a lot of other things that we can do if we have the will and we make the decision to do it.
Great, thank you. So we're going to open it up to questions. I want to thank the folks that have the microphones. I ask you when you ask a question to let us know where you are at the institution and who you are. So I have a question right here, the gentleman in the red and black shirt, and then I have a question. Let's bring the other mic right up here to the front.
Hi, my name is Ben. I'm a 1L. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit more, Professor Zakharoff, you mentioned this, a little bit more about how the role of political parties might shift. There was some talk in some sectors that this might fundamentally change some of the ways that political parties choose to use their resources, and some of the traditional roles of political parties might be taken up by corporate-backed independent groups. Do you think this is going to be a sea change, or do you think this is going to be sort of more of the same, an extension of 527s, et cetera? Thank you.
I think that 5 years from now, we're going to look back and think that the practical effect of this opinion was actually quite small. And the reason for that is that the parties have fundamentally reorganized themselves on the issue of campaign spending. And so the party, when candidates were squeezed and parties were not, because of state regulations and various technical things in the 90s, a lot of money went into the parties through, you know, the most notorious were the Clinton coffee clatches and rides on Air Force One and things of that sort. But the money went into the parties. And what the parties have done is they have centralized their expenditures nationally. I'm going to talk just about federal elections. And one of the most interesting things is that they now control a huge amount of the campaign resources that are spent through the congressional and through the House and Senate election committees. They have different names for each of the parties, but there's basically one for each of the parties. And what they have started to do is to direct their spending, their resource allocation, to the few contested elections that there are, which tend now to be extremely well-funded on both sides, which has had the salutary effect of making it hard for the issue ad folks to come in and buy up lots of airtime, because the markets are so saturated now, it's really hard to get airtime. It's really hard to do anything of note, because the parties are relatively well-funded. So I think that the main reform that has had an effect here is actually the Bipartisan Campaign Reform Act, BCRA, or McCain-Feingold, in a part that nobody pays attention to, which is it radically increased the amount of hard money that could be raised by candidates and parties. And as a result, the party apparatus is better funded. So I think that the effect of Citizens United is actually going to be relatively limited, with one possible exception, which is you really want to be concerned about the shakedown effect. Most of the discussion is about, oh, the corporations want to speak. When you talk to corporate officials, it turns out very few of them want to speak at all, because every time you speak, you lose customers. And it turns out that the best study of this, done by a political scientist at University of California, San Diego, Gary Jacobson, reveals that major corporations, even when allowed to by state law, don't speak. They don't want to endorse candidates unless they get shaken down. The corporations that do speak tend to be either single proprietorships or family-controlled ones, like Walmart or something like that, where there's a dominant family. So that's the shakedown problem is a real one.
I agree that I think that the shakedown is where the real problem is going to be here. Don't agree that the fact that the political parties raise more money and hard money is really necessarily going to counteract what happens here. I mean, any sizable corporation could devote 1% of its profits, not even 1% of its revenues, but 1% of its profits and outspend both political parties combined. It's a difference in orders of magnitude. In 2008, Exxon raised $700,000 for its PAC, saying, everyone who wants to support the Exxon agenda, ante up. Their corporate profits in that same year were $45 billion. That's 50,000 times more money. And, both parties combined spent, I think, probably less than $1 billion in the 2008 elections. But I did want to, I also wanted to mention, because Floyd said, the PAC money is not the same as the company. And he said, if you're going to regulate, find a non-speech way of doing it. If money is speech, then there is no non-speech way of doing it. They had a non-speech way of doing it. It was saying, corporations, if you want to get involved in partisan politics, do so through a separate segregated fund rather than using your general treasury funds. That is a money regulation. It's the Supreme Court who has made that a speech regulation.
Good, thanks. So before you go, can I see hands of who else wants to ask a question? Got a mic right up here, and then here. So you've got the mic. We'll bring another one right up to the front, please. All the way up front.
Hello, I'm Alex Papakristou. Mr. Abrams, your First Amendment sounds wonderful. I just can't afford it. And before corporations, as persons, gain the vote that persons have, I wonder if you could explain to us what you alluded to earlier, and that is how government can rein in corporations so that they don't have so much influence in the political process. How legally, constitutionally, can you tell us it can be done? Could you please make it something that you would be willing to defend yourself in the Supreme Court?
Sure. Well, look, one thing that can be done is to deal with the rights of shareholders. As Sam rightly said, this was never a shareholders protection bill, but one could have one. One could certainly adopt. I'm not sure if the federal government could or not, but that's not a First Amendment issue. Certainly Delaware could have a Delaware rule, and probably the federal government could have a rule applicable in most cases anyway, requiring some sort of shareholder approval before companies engaged in political activities of certain sorts. What I was referring to earlier, though, was the more pervasive issue of the power of corporations in American life, even beyond politics or political spending. We have always had the power. Indeed, the Obama administration is talking about it in some areas in the financial area, to avoid companies being too big to fail, to keep companies from growing beyond certain levels. Justice Brandeis, when he was in private practice, certainly favored that sort of approach. And we have taxing powers, we have antitrust laws, which could be significantly increased. Would I favor them? Most of them I would not favor, but they would all be constitutional, and none of them would even begin to touch on the First Amendment.
Can I just interject a quick question, which is, so I gather that there's not much evidence that corporations are going to rush in to take advantage of this, but also some, and I'd be curious if there's evidence that that's wrong, so I'll turn to Monica first if she wants to jump in on that. And then second, that the shakedown is a problem, though, so I'd be curious to know how the solution runs on that.
I mean, I think that the amount of money that corporations spend on lobbying, which is an indirect way to influence government, you know, can be seen as the amount of political spending they want to engage in as some kind of a proxy. And, you know, and if you think about corporations spending the same amount on what they spend lobbying on indirect influence as, you know, as they would on direct influence, then that itself would swamp our political system. I don't know necessarily that will happen, but there's certainly a potential, and certainly it's something that every elected official is going to have to take into account when he or she goes into a negotiation. I think, you know, Representative Nadler was not able to be here today, but I was testifying in House Judiciary a couple weeks ago, and he came up with the following story from his experience as a politician, which was a story from Poughkeepsie, and he said that, you know, there a local developer really wanted to build a mall, and the swing vote on the city council was opposed to that. The corporation under wraps, launched a smear campaign. Of course, it had nothing to do with the mall, just a smear campaign against this legislator. They spent about 10 times as much as everyone else in the race combined on the smear campaign. Poughkeepsie saw nothing but the smear campaign against this legislator. And at the end of the day, they, of course, voted the legislator out. Only after that was it disclosed that, in fact, the mall people had been funding this campaign. And what the question I think that Professor Zakharov refers to is, what is the recourse of the citizens of Poughkeepsie there? I mean, they can't hold the new legislator accountable for that. It's really not that person's fault. But, you know, their election has been dominated by, you know, taken over by, has been hijacked by a single issue, and they have no one they can hold accountable for it.
Well, let me give a slightly counter example. We do know what has been spent by corporations in places where they're free to spend, so that in California and state elections, they're free to spend. And we have data for the last 5 years of who the top 10 spenders in California were. And it turns out among the top 10, I think they're number 8 and 10, so they're pretty close to the bottom, are two very wealthy individuals who were friends of a candidate for governor. Okay, so they spent a lot. The other 8 were either labor unions or Indian tribes. And it turns out that corporations have huge amounts of money, but they rarely have the concentrated incentive. Another example, in Oregon, there was the legislature passed an unfunded budget of $770 million overage. Oregon has a constitutional requirement of a balanced budget. So they then went to a referendum before the public saying, let's tax individuals who make more than a certain amount, something fine, that's a policy question, and let's put a payroll tax on all businesses. the businesses in Oregon went bonkers. They said, are you kidding? We have 10% unemployment. We can't afford this. This is going to make us uncompetitive. They did spend some money as corporations to try to defeat it, but they have a massive collective action problem. They don't organize as such, and they were swamped by guess whom? The public employee unions, who had a strong vested interest in this particular issue. Corporations, the problem is for them, and what's good for us is they tend not to speak with one voice. And the evidence where in half the states where you do have corporate participation, you get cases like the Poughkeepsie mayor, I don't know anything about that, but you get cases like this, but the evidence is just not there that this is what they really want to do. They don't care who gets into office so much because their view is that through lobbying they can buy whoever is in office once they're there. Why take a chance by potentially funding their rival? And it turns out that the market efficiencies do work here, and they seem to prefer lobbying to campaign contributions, except when they get shaken down by incumbents who say, don't come see me in January if you don't see me first in October. And that's a real issue.
So I'm going to just jump in because I'm starting to see lots of hands. We've got a mic here. Let's keep questions short. And then I don't know where the other mic is, but there's a hand all the way in back. Great. You're up.
Hi. Helena Haywood. I'm a 1L. My question is for whomever would like to address it. Do you think the current discord within the ACLU is temporary, making this decision more like a Skokie moment, or do you think it represents a fundamental change in the direction of the organization, and if so, is that a direction that should be pursued?
I'd like to try that first. For those of you that haven't followed this, it's public now that the American Civil Liberties Union, which has been on what I will loosely call the free speech side of this issue.
I'm sorry, Floyd, I hate to interrupt you. I'm gonna be in charge of where the mics go if I can. Thank you.
Sure. For the last 30 years, and who submitted a brief in the McConnell case on my side, and a brief on the same side, although not quite as vigorous a brief in this case, has been considering, or is reconsidering, as the questioner rightly suggests, its position on this area. It's an issue which has divided the ACLU for many years, although the leadership of it has consistently come out the same way. I think that this will continue to be an issue which divides the organization, almost in the same way that Sam was suggesting that Supreme Court decisions find themselves pulled in opposite directions by egalitarian and liberty-oriented orientations. I don't know where they're going to come out on this. When I appeared before them a few weeks ago, I urged on them what I believe, which is that I thought it would be a terrible thing for the ACLU as an organization to become just another liberal pressure group. That the major thing they can do, in my view, is to stay the world's most important civil liberties group. And that, in my view, they're at their best when they're defending Oliver North when he takes the Fifth Amendment, and Rush Limbaugh when he takes pills and then takes the position that he has some privacy interest in not having certain information be made public. That's my view. But one way or the other, I think this is an issue which will continue to divide that organization.
Good. The mic's back there. Who else has a question? So I'm going to move a mic here. So even though I have control over the mic, I'm going to put it where it wanted to go. And then can we move the mic next to the gentleman all the way in the back?
My question is similar but a little more broad. And it's for Mr. Abrams particularly.
Tell us who you are.
I'm Kate. I'm a 2L. I want to know, you know, as you alluded to earlier, you said First Amendment decisions are often very unpopular, and has been alluded to, this one seems to be in that vein. I want to know if you see any difference in the criticism of this decision versus that of past decisions, and whether all of the outcry now should worry people who see the First Amendment as you do.
I think it is different in the sense that the press, with the exception of certain organs on the right, are pretty much as one in opposing this ruling. Whereas in a more traditional civil liberties context, no matter how unpopular a decision is, it tends to get a good deal of support from the what I will call the more traditional civil liberties community. Now, I'm not talking about the ACLU for these purposes, but I mean the establishment press has generally been very protective, at least they think they are, of civil liberties. Their view on this one is entirely different. I mean, one can read a whole editorial in the New York Times today on this subject without coming upon either the word first or amendment.
Yeah, I'll just say in passing, it is interesting that Floyd's right that the court's First Amendment decisions often tend to be less popular than some of their other civil liberties decisions, but they always have a really good friend in the media when they decide those cases. So this is an interesting case in the sense that the media is after them. We have a question here, and we want to move the mic all the way to the gentleman in the back over there, if we can.
Yes, Victor Kovner. I was hoping the panel could say a word or two about the question of whether the issue that was decided was properly before the court. The Stevens dissent makes a forceful case that that issue had been dismissed below, and some have characterized the courts when they asked for a re-argument as really reaching out and framing an issue not properly before them in a matter of unprecedented judicial activism.
When do we have Sam first?
Unprecedented judicial activism.
Judicial activism is always unprecedented.
So let me give an anecdote as to why I think this is not correct. The group that put out Hillary the movie, Citizens United, wanted to put out a flyer advertising the movie. Now, if the flyer were prohibited under the relevant provision, they would have been subject, as Floyd says, to criminal prosecution, right? So you could go to jail. I mean, it's unlikely you go to jail, but it's criminal prosecution if they got this wrong. They submitted the flyer, not the movie, the flyer advertising the movie, to the Federal Elections Commission. Now, the Federal Elections Commission is nobody's idea of good government. Let's be candid. It's, you know, I've often described it as, among tough competition, the worst agency in Washington. And but they sat on this for over 8 months to determine whether or not this was criminally prohibited. And finally, I think it was in June of 2009, they said, we think that on balance it's okay. Now, you may have noticed June 2009 is slightly after the November election. So it permits speech way after the fact when it has no effect and has no audience. It seems to me that if we take the First Amendment seriously and we worry about chilling effects on speech, that the majority opinion is absolutely right that it had to engage this issue because there is serious chilling effect here. Now, it could have gone the other way, but I think that the idea that the constitutionality of the statute was not posed and that the question of various provisions of McCain-Feingold Act, I find that impossible to believe. That was all over the cert petitions. That's what the order was on rehearing. I think that oftentimes procedural arguments are make weight. And I think that the losing side raises procedural objections, and that's as it should be. But at this point, we have the real hard issue that we have to confront here. And I find this particular line of attack not persuasive.
I do think on the
chilling argument. I mean, the court had the option to decide this law on vagueness grounds, and I think that all of us who care about the First Amendment would say that, yes, it's an important for a law that carries potential criminal penalties not to be vague. It's important for a law that, you know, attempts to regulate in this area of the law not to be vague. But the court did not rule on that ground, on vagueness grounds. The court went much, much further than that. And I think that part of, you know, and what's particularly problematic about that is a lot of the at least some of the vagueness at issue was due to the result of the court's 2007 decision in Wisconsin Right to Life, where the court had taken, you know, what was a clear rule, you're not allowed to mention a candidate between 30 and 60 days through use of these funds in a certain specified time before the election, has said, well, that's only true for what is the functional equivalent of express advocacy, you know, itself a vague law, and then it creates a vague rule, and then it criticizes the rule it created for being vague. And I think that the court did reach out to decide this case on grounds that were narrower than the case before it, and I find that troubling because, you know, precedent aside, one of the reasons we have Article III case or controversy requirements is so that an otherwise uncheckable body cannot constitute itself as a roving commission to strike down laws it doesn't like. It's an important part of our checks and balances that the court does not go further than it is. And if the court says money is speech, and any regulation of money potentially involves a chilling effect, and we have to rule broadly in every area, then that really just knocks checks and balances out of the picture.
Can I add that I don't view the statute as vague right now, or as of the time it reached the court. It either violated the First Amendment or it didn't, but I don't think vagueness was the primary flaw of it. I mean, I think we have to accept the proposition that we deal here in an area, however the court came out on this case, that is suffused with First Amendment interests, if not enough in some of the cases, to carry the day. So when you say that the law, you know, had been really nice and clear, sure, it had been very clear that just the mention of a candidate, not an endorsement, not even a tip of the hat in the direction of the candidate, not even if it had nothing to do with the election, but the mention of the candidate within 60 days of the election, 30 of a convention, et cetera, was criminal under the statute as written. And that wasn't vague. We all understood that. But Congress thought, and Congress was very concerned, that would be held unconstitutional for reasons that we all understand, and had a backup definition of which the court in its later decision took some form of in articulating its principle. This is an area in which regulation of speech or speech permitting activities will always run the gamut of being clear and death on speech, or vague and therefore allowing more speech. But it will always be an area in which the speech interest is very real, and in which some very hard decisions have to be made.
Great. In the back.
Hi, my name is Daniel. I'm a 1L. My question is, I know there's legislation working through Congress, stand by your ad legislation. So, you know, hi, my name is Exxon, and I approve this message. Do you think that kind of that would take care of some of the accountability issues that you were discussing previously? And is that a constitutional approach as well?
I just want to expand your question a little bit, because I'm curious about that. And I'd actually be interested, as people respond, to hear about other alternative suggestions that are happening in Congress right now, and what the likelihood is of those passing and what effect they might have.
I mean, there have always been corporate disclosure requirements, and they have always been evaded as corporations set up shell corporation after shell corporation. I'm thinking of a zoning case in Littleton where Walmart styled itself Littleton neighbors voting no on a particular zoning referendum. It's very, very hard to you know, disclosure is necessary, but disclosure is not sufficient to resolve the accountability problem that we've been talking about here, because at the end of the day, the voters don't get to vote for or against Walmart. The voters don't get to vote Walmart out of office. And to the extent that, you know, the election is hijacked by Walmart, the voters don't have any recourse.
Sam?
Well, there's a lot of things you can do with corporate regulation if you wanted to. You could certainly pass rules of general application about the use of treasury funds from a corporation that prohibit them not being directed toward economic activity. I think that would have that would shut down every museum in the country, but, you know, who goes to those anyway? So that's one possibility. A second possibility is one that I find more intriguing, which is it goes back to this old debate about whether we should permit strikes by public sector unions. And the wisdom going back half a century was that it's very dangerous to democracy to allow double dipping by any vested institutional actor. And so it may be that what we want to prohibit is corporations that do business with the government, for example, TARP recipients, from lobbying or spending money in conjunction with certain policy issues that affect them in their contractual relations with the government. I think that that would be a sufficiently neutral, generalized interest that might have some real bite, the same way that we may want to prohibit, for example, public sector unions from engaging in the same kind of activity. There are going to be constitutional issues around the line drawing, but we can draw these kinds of lines. Most of what is going through Congress right now, or the initial impulse, is always the quick fix, let's make the last case come out differently. And in doing so, I think that most of what Congress is debating is going to run smack into First Amendment problems, because they're not generalizable. They just want to stop corporations from giving money to candidates. But what about giving money to the pet charities of an incumbent congressional figure? I mean, if you're talking about possibilities, corruption, distortion, access that's not visible to the public, all these kinds of concerns, that's got to dwarf this. And finally, keep in mind, campaign contributions is tiny compared to lobbying. Lobbying is where the real distortions of money and policy come, I think, in our democracy. And why are we, why the focus on this, you know, sometimes escapes me. Why there's a moral quality to it, which I understand, but I'm a little at a loss here.
We're out of time, so we're at a loss and out of time. I have a couple of announcements I want to make. The time went very quickly. So one is, as Monica pointed out, Representative Nadler planned to be here. You may or may not know this, but St. Vincent's Hospital, which serves this neighborhood, is in very serious financial trouble, and the governor called him and some others to a meeting to try to work that out. So he sends his regrets, and I told him we'll have him back at another time. Also, I just want to tell you that next week the forum is going to be on lessons for activists, what I didn't learn in law school or didn't focus on while I was in law school. And we've got three wonderful activists who are coming, but I think this is going to be interest to all folks who want to be lawyers. So we'll see you then. Thanks so much to the panel. It was terrific.